Okay, so we're going to animate our horse walking. And this is the formula that we're going to use, a 32-frame walk cycle, starting at frame 1 up here with the rear right foot contact and ending up down here at number 33, which is the same as 1, again with the rear right foot contact. This is quite a slow horse walk. It's relatively simplified, and what it allows you to do is basically you just have to do your first pose and your last pose, which are of course the same, then the pose in the middle, number 17, which is halfway between them, then you drop in 9 and 25, which is halfway between those two, and then you do 5, 13, 21 and 29, which is halfway between these two. So it allows you to, basically means you only have to do 8 key poses, or 8 poses in order to get the walk cycle working right. So it's as simple as I can make it in order to get an efficient result. And when I say as simple as I can make it, I say that because it is tricky animating a horse walking in a convincing way. And there's lots that can go wrong. And in particular, it's very easy to make the shapes on the animal look weird. But let's start at the beginning. According to the Animator's Survival Kit, all animal walks are basically alike. That is to some degree true. And it's a good idea to actually stop the video now, get down on all fours, and try walking around on all fours, because we are basically... we're obviously bipeds, but we were once upon a time in the mists of our evolutionary past, we were quadrupeds, and we walked on all fours like most other mammals do. And you'll see as you walk around that it's really the back legs which are driving it. And as your back leg, let's say the rear right leg here, as that comes forward, it sets off the front right leg. And then your rear left leg comes forward, and that sets off the front left leg. So you'll see when you try it that it's basically all coming from the rear. It's all coming from your hips. Now, I won't go into animal anatomy in any great detail. There's a separate lecture for that. But just bear in mind that whilst cats have a very flexible spine, and also rabbits, as you can see here, horses have a very inflexible spine. They're like cows. Their spines don't bend much. So you don't want to bend this too much, or it will stop feeling like a horse. As with everything, we always want to go to MyBridge for reference. He's a marvelous source of information about horses and all kinds of different other animals. Nowadays, there's other reference as well. I highly recommend this website, horselocomotion.com. Which has tons of really good stuff on horse walks, and some of it is motion capture data, which is really good, really well worth downloading and using for reference. And they've got a YouTube channel. So www.horselocomotion.com is a must go-to website before you start. Okay, so let's break it down. Let's take the pelvis first, and the pelvis is basically just like the human walk, in the sense you've got your contact position, you've got your down or squash position, you're passing, then you're up, and then contact. So it's just like a human walk in the sense that all the positions we're familiar with, contact, down, passing, up, and contact, are present in the horse walk as well. And you'll also find that the front of the horse is just the same. The chest goes down on the contact position, and then the chest goes up on the passing position, just like the back legs. Now, in the horse walk, when the rear is up, that is to say, when the pelvis is up, the chest is going to be down. And conversely, when the chest is up, the pelvis will be down. So you're going to get this effect: chest up, hips down, chest down, hips up. So this is basically how a horse walks. Front and back go up and down in opposition to one another. When you add the head tends to work with the pelvis. So when the pelvis goes down, the head is going to go down. When the pelvis goes up, the head is going to go up. And you end up with this effect here. pelvis up, head up, pelvis down, head down. Okay, so the front and the back of the horse are moving in opposition, and the head is moving in opposition to the shoulders or the chest. Now, where is the driving force coming from? Which is really driving this, the hips or the chest? And the answer, of course, is the power is coming from the rear. And the way a horse moves is the back legs are pushing and the front legs are basically steering. So if you're animating, let's say you're animating a horse galloping and it were to turn, it's the back legs that turn first and then the front legs follow. Always the back legs first. Now, what about the spine? In a dog, you're going to find a lot of side-to-side motion in the spine. But in a horse, you tend to have a lot less flexibility there. So probably not too much twisting in the spine there. Here's a relatively fast 16-frame horse walk. That would be quite a quick walk. And here's the basic formula. The rear left foot contact. At frame 3, you've got the hips down and the chest up. At frame 5, the hips are going up and the chest is going down. You've got the front left foot contact. And I always write this down on my thumbnails, and I highly recommend that you do too, because it gets really confusing when you're dealing with two sets of legs. And you want to make sure that you know which part of the horse is moving up and which part of it is moving down and which legs are contacting. Frame 7, rear part of the horse is going up and the shoulders are going down. Frame 9 is the rear right foot contact and the shoulders are going up. Frame 11, hips going down again, shoulders going up. Frame 13, front right foot contact, shoulders going down, hips going up. Frame 15, hips going up, shoulders going down. And frame 1 is the same as 17. We're back to frame 1 again with the rear left foot contact. So you want to make sure that your thumbnails are really, really clear, and I recommend you use the ones that that I've got here. But make sure that you print it out nice and clearly and then have it in front of you when you're working. So there's our 16-frame horse walk. And here's a slightly slower 24-frame version of the same thing. But we're going to do this one here, a 32-frame cycle. This is the same one I showed you at the beginning, starting with the rear right foot contact and ending with the rear right foot contact. And in fact, when we're doing our animation, all of our cycles are going to start off with the rear right foot contact, and that will make it easier if you want to do a transition between them so that you can always pick it up from exactly the same point in the cycle. Okay, so the rig we want to look for is at Creative Crash. Here's the link. And it's called Rep the Clydesdale if you want to Google it. There are a number of free horse rigs, but I'm going to recommend this one to you. Make sure you give its creator credit when you put it on your demo reel. It is free, but obviously we always like to credit the very talented people whose work we depend on to get our work done. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to animate the horse walking on the spot. That means you're going to have to animate the feet traveling underneath the body with the body staying still at the origin point throughout. So you're not going to have any forward translation on the body. You're going to have the feet traveling underneath. Now that does mean that you've got to keep a special eye on the feet because otherwise they tend to drift and it can become difficult to control the motion of the feet underneath. But that's the best way of doing it with the horse, is to animate it walking on the spot. You could animate the horse walking across the screen, but it is harder to cycle the animation later. And what we want to do is to get a really good cycle working. So in the long run, this will be a better method of working. And you want to work on spline curves, of course, as you would with any walk cycle, so that Maya can do the in-betweens for us. Okay, so getting started. You're going to start with the rear right foot contact of frame 1 and then do frame 33, that is to say the same as frame 1. And then the next thing you're going to do is the middle position. That is frame 17, and that's the rear left foot contact. And that's the mirror image of positions 1 and 33. Then once you've done that, you're going to add the other two contact positions. at frame 9, that's up here, that's the front right foot contact, and then at 25, front left foot contact. So now you've got 1, 17, 33, 9, and 25. That's all your contact positions done. Stage 5, you're going to add the other four breakdown positions. That's this one here at frame 5, 13, 21, and 29. Frame 5 is now the high point on the shoulders, so bear that in mind, and the low point on the hips. Frame 13 is the low point on the shoulders and the high point on the hips. Frame 21, high point on the shoulders, low point on the hips. And frame 29, again, low point on the shoulders, high point on the hips. Very important that you get these two elements working in opposition to one another. If you're having any trouble with it, and you probably will have some trouble with it because it's not easy, you might want to try just doing taking the rear legs as a separate element and then doing the front legs afterwards. So treating it as two separate bits. That is one way of approaching this if you're having difficulty. Now, once you've got your basic cycle working, you're going to want to add, that is to say, with the up and down on the chest and the hips, you're going to want to add some overlapping action. When the head goes up, the ears are going to go down. When the head goes down, the ears are going to go up. When the pelvis goes down, the tail is going to go up a bit, and when the pelvis goes up, the tail is going to go down a bit. One of the reasons I like to animate with Rhett the Clydesdale is he hasn't got much of a tail, and that saves us a lot of trouble in our animation because doing the overlapping action on the tail is a pain in the neck. I mean, it looks nice when it's done, but we've got enough difficulties or enough complexity with this exercise without adding more. You could also add a little motion on the jaw. Maybe his jaw just gently drifts open and shut as he walks. And you can also control the nostrils on this rig, so you can animate and flare the nostrils a bit to suggest that he's breathing as he moves. A little bit of troubleshooting notes on this. You must make sure that when on the front right foot contact, that this leg is straight. And here, as the leg travels underneath the horse, make sure it stays straight. Very easy for this leg to bend, and we instinctively want to bend the leg because we think of a bent leg as taking weight. But the front legs of a horse do not bend as they travel underneath the horse. They will stay completely rigid. As soon as they start to bend, it'll start to feel like a pantomime horse. Now, on Rhett, these front legs can be a little bit difficult to straighten out. But if you look on the foot control, you'll find the compress fetlock slider, and you can use that to adjust the fetlock down here, and that will help you straighten out that leg. So that is a useful little control to find on the Rhett rig. Now, very, very important when you're animating, make sure your reference is in front of you. And by that I mean print out the thumbnails and put them on the desktop. Don't keep them as a JPEG on your screen because you won't look at it. Or rather, your screen is going to be so full of other stuff that you'll forget about it. So print it out and have it in front of you next to your desk, and that way you can look up at your animation and down at your thumbnails so that you can always look back at your thumbnails if you start to drift off target. All right, good luck and happy animating.